In the previous video, we saw about how a single user's DMLs and commit is processed. Now, in a general database environment where we have an application and there are multiple users or multiple applications connecting, we don't have a single user working on the database at any given time. There are many, many users, right? So then how does it work? Every user who performs his changes will result in log buffer entries being created. So let me bring in changes with respect to each one of them. And the reason I'm giving it that they are spread across is, let's say user one makes a DML. He doesn't commit yet, but at the same time, simultaneously user two makes his DML, user three makes his DML. So the log buffer entries could get interlaced between the various transactions that are being done by the users. Now, let's say only user 3 issues his commit. If only user 3 is going to issue a commit, it means user 1 and user 2's changes are not to be committed. But the behavior is that when log writer writes down to the read log files, it not only writes the changes that are with respect to the user 3 who is committing, but actually it empties down all the contents of the changes that are present in the log buffer. But the only thing is, the SCN would have got generated only for user 3. That's why I'm giving a black color. So the SCN is available only for user 3 means, as far as the commit is concerned, it is only for the black transaction or user 3's transaction. But the log buffer entries for all the users' DMLs are written down. But note, the changes in the buffer cache have happened for all the users who have made changes. So that is not changed. So I'm just representing black, blue and red as the blocks and rows which have been modified by the respective colored users. Now, user 3's transaction is committed. You might expect that it has to write it to the data file, but it doesn't write it. DB writer is responsible for writing it later. Whenever there is a need, it will write. We will not get about it right now. We'll get to that later. Basically, writing to data files is costlier than writing to read log files, because whenever a data file is written, it has to write the entire block. Whereas here, it is only the change that has happened. A change could be a few bytes, whereas a block is at least 2 kilobytes. So the amount of I/O to happen is much higher. So from an architecture perspective, it is good to just write whatever changes have occurred. Now, when I say whatever changes have occurred, all the entries in the read log buffer would have been emptied when you do a commit. And with that, in case my DB buffers are not written into my data files and my instance crashes, I can recover it from here. Or if I have configured for archive log mode, where read log file copies are kept elsewhere, a few days later, if I lose my database or if I lose a particular data file, I can still get back the transactions. I don't want to ask my users to enter changes. So that is how a typical transaction processing environment in an Oracle database happens.